the Mediterranean, a mysterious ocean between three continents. Life pulses right beneath the surface. Day by day, the historic fight for food and habitat ensues. A clear hierarchy within a community of hunters and hunted, with the exception of a few. The great white shark. We will follow this predator into a foreign, rarely entered world with all kinds of mysteries, wondrous phenomena, and dangers. We will encounter bizarre mystery mongers and some very curious types. Shoulder to shoulder with the ocean's creatures, we are chasing a mystery. The mystery of the mating of the bluefin tuna. Our search begins in the Strait of Gibraltar, the only connection between Atlantic and Mediterranean Ocean. Here, we cannot miss the tuna. This maritime bottleneck between Africa and Europe is only 14 kilometers wide at the narrowest spot. 1.5 million cubic meters per second of Atlantic Ocean rush into the Mediterranean and back out again at great depth. Between April and September, bluefin Atlantic tuna swim through the strait to spawn in the warmer Mediterranean waters. A great white has killed a tuna. He followed the schools. The ferocious shark is never far from the tuna schools. Orcas are the main predators of tuna. The cool Atlantic water is nutrient-rich, ideal for the majestic Morula race. They filter plankton. Willyjacks also profit from the countless microbes. Lightning-fast Atlantic marlin prey on sardines. A school of pilot whales has arrived. These 5 to 6 meter long mammals give birth here and then also mate again. Right beneath the surface, a school of scats is trying to keep safe from dolphins and shearwaters by forming a rotating ball. But the predators know no mercy. Right after the dolphins are satisfied, pompanos decide to feed on their weaker cousins. Suddenly they arrive, bluefin tuna on the way to their spawning grounds. The harbor of Tarifa. Boris Frenzel-Beimer arrived just in time in the small Spanish fishing village. Here, in the Strait of Gibraltar, the German marine biologist starts his journey to follow the tuna on board of a fishing boat. The hunt for the highly valuable fish is quite dangerous in the 60 kilometer long, narrow strait between Africa and Europe. The list of tragic accidents grows longer each year. About 250 ships move past each other every day. Often fog and tricky currents play their own games here. Orcas make fishing very difficult. These clever predators rob their own two-legged competitors of about 80% of the catch. A whole army of snitches comes together here. Sharks are there almost immediately when the fishing boats arrive, but also yellowfin tuna find bits and pieces once they're sought after family members are hanging on the hooks of the fishermen. Mackerel are used as bait to lure the tuna onto the fishing hooks. Cinder blocks keep the bait floating in the current at depth. Boreas wants to know if it's true that 80% of the catch is eaten by orcas and sharks. He doesn't have to wait long for proof. This bait has just been thrown in the water and is now being torn apart by two blue sharks. Mackerel are too small for the orcas. They wait until the tuna has bit into a hook. Only in the last moment do they take their bite, very frustrating for the fishermen.
No!
This Moroccan has more luck. He can live off the money he gets for this tuna for months. The fishermen that the biologist goes along with are not concerned when a small great white shark takes their bait. The fishing boats are not very popular here. Some ocean dwellers work up quite a rage. A bottlenose dolphin shows his anger. The orcas are the most dangerous. He has killed a young dolphin. Excitement among the fishermen. Unfortunately, only a shark again. The tuna fishermen are angry, but this is actually very dangerous for the shark population. Boris takes a detour to Tangiers, on the Moroccan-African side of the Strait of Gibraltar. Typical Oriental smells and offerings lure our biologist into the jumble of small alleyways in the bazaar. But the biologist only has one goal, to find the fish market. He wants to find out the truth about reports which claim that Moroccan tuna fishermen catch 100,000 blue and mako sharks every year, as so-called bycatch. It seems these reports could be true. The supply seems surprisingly high. In this market alone, he counts 56 blue sharks ready to be auctioned off. The bycatch market is booming. Especially the shark fins will get the fishermen high prices in Asia, used as potency and beauty-enhancing products. A great business for these fishermen, and that's almost every day of the year. A 3-meter-50 long male mako shark. The shark expert has never seen a mako this large. We leave Tangiers for a quick visit to the Atlantic coast. Our destination is the old harbor town north of Agadir, Essaouira. This place was also well known to the Phoenicians in the 7th century BC and also to the Romans later on. For a long time, Essaouira was the hub for caravans and is now one of the most important harbors in Morocco. Here, the fishermen fish as much as the ocean will let them take, and that is still quite a lot. The reason for this richness of all kinds of seafood cannot be found in the colorful fishing boats that are waiting for the next trip to go out. The reason lies way off coast, out in the Atlantic. Cool, deep sea water rises up to the surface and supplies large kelp fields with nutrients. A mystical, seemingly enchanted forest. Bluefin tuna and countless other ocean dwellers use these rich coastal areas to feed before they start their long journey through the Mediterranean. The same goes for the blue sharks and even more dangerous mako sharks. They follow the tuna in order to catch one of them every once in a while, a long-time predatory relationship that has never caused any harm to the tuna population. The leftovers of the meal sink to the ocean floor. Rare guitar fish will make a meal of it. we travel into the country to find out for how long sharks have been hunting tuna here. In the Atlas Mountains, close to Caribga, in a landscape of wild and untouched beauty. In the debris of the river shore, only a trained eye will find these rare fossilized treasures. This piece lets us surmise the evolutionary history that has taken place in these mountains. The find is a shark tooth. Form and function offer a lot of information about its original owner. 50 million years ago, a shallow shelf ocean covered most parts of North Africa. Today's mountains used to be giant coral reefs. Here, the ancestor of the great white used to patrol these reefs. Its name is Otodus obliquus. 10 meters long, he was able to swallow tuna whole without tearing them apart. A monster of ancient times that we can only imagine. Back to Gibraltar, we follow the tuna on their migrations to the spawning grounds in the western and eastern Mediterranean. Boris decided to first take a scuba dive in the Strait of Gibraltar and gets a surprise. Large brown algae bends back and forth in the current. This kelp is usually found in the Atlantic. In this zone, where the Atlantic and the Mediterranean mix, we find the fauna and flora of both oceans. An eagle ray can feel that the diver discovered him. This species can be found in both oceans. Barbs dig for something to eat. The two banded breams are intensively shadowing the barbs in case a tasty morsel escapes the barbs. The eagle ray is not the only one of his species in the Strait of Gibraltar. Cownose rays school in large numbers above the soft sand ground. Not the last surprise for Boris. An anglerfish has left its hideout. Anglerfish this large have become rare. Their numbers have been reduced quite a bit because anglerfish have become a favorite fish to eat. Boris makes friends with a lesser spotted dogfish. This young shark has probably never seen such a strange creature. Not a friendship for life, but an interesting encounter for both, nevertheless. In the waters around Gibraltar are several wrecks, quiet witnesses of long-forgotten catastrophes. But nature has long taken over the numerous nooks and crannies and has created an underwater paradise. Moray eels prefer this unusual habitat with its many hideouts. Sunfish show up, also migrating from the Atlantic to the Mediterranean. Here, in the bottleneck of the oceans, their paths cross with those of the tuna. Both are here for spawning, and for many of them, it's unfortunately only a one-way trip. Off the Spanish coastal town Barbate, many of the tuna get stuck in a cunning trap, a labyrinth of a kilometer-long gill net system, the almadraba. There is no getting out once caught in these nets. The animals are killed or just knocked out with clubs and then thrown into the boats. The smaller yellowfin tuna often escape the giant trap. Barely freed, and they're already feeding on the bits and pieces of the gruesomely killed tuna. Sharks, such as Marcos, that are bycatch themselves, profit from the fishermen throwing everything but tuna back into the sea. Victims of the almadraba often become the provisions for the journey of the survivors. The bloody business continues in the harbor. Boris has driven to Barbata, where the catch arrives and is examined before it's sold, mostly to Japan. The bluefin tuna is one of the largest fish in the oceans. It can grow up to 4.5 meters long and can weigh as much as 700 kilograms, but neither Boris nor the fishermen will ever get to see such a large specimen nowadays. What is caught today is far from any previous record measurements. Most tuna end up on a hook before they can ever reproduce for the first time at the age of 8 years old. The populations are overfished and some even close to extinction. In Japan, wholesalers will earn as much as 70,000 euros per tuna. Although the Spanish fishermen only get a very small portion of the money, it is still a great business for them. A dire future for the tuna. We leave this strait and follow the tuna on their journey towards the northern Mediterranean. Our destination is a group of islands between the Balearic Islands and the Spanish coastline. The Islas de Colombretes are a protected national park and also a spawning ground for the tuna. The small archipelago was created by a sunken volcano. And what we see is what's left of the rim of the crater. In order to step on these islands, the Spanish regional government of Valencia has to give permission. The same goes for scuba diving. Boris is greeted by a beautiful grouper. Because of their flavorful meat, these fish have become rare in the Mediterranean. A trader fish is curious about the reflection in the camera lens and decides to check it out with its strong jaws. The waters around the Colombretes also offer these wrasse a safe haven. Colorful and poisonous, a scorpion fish.
Yes.
Boris and his colleague Antonio Montiel put a tow cam in the water. Since not a single tuna has shown up yet, they want to try to find them with the camera offshore. This unique construction is made to be towed behind a boat in order to deliver shots of a wider area. First, common dolphins are the stars on screen. Curious as they are, these intelligent toothed whales inspect the camera. As a result, Boris gets wonderful test shots. Boris and Antonio are happy with the camera, it works well, but they still can't find tuna. Calm seas. The men hope that maybe during the night they will discover the tuna. Boris checks another special camera, a pole cam. With this camera, he wants to observe marine life while they are drifting with the boat. Patience is most important. After waiting almost all night, finally bluefin tuna appear in front of the night vision camera, a highlight for the team in this darkness. Unfortunately, they can't film any mating. So far, it's only known that the eggs are fertilized in the open water and that they float along for about 2 days. During this time, 3 millimeter long larvae develop in each egg that then hatch and grow very quickly. Boris has left the Islas Colombretas and is flying towards Mallorca. Between the Colombretas and Mallorca live the tuna larvae and their main enemy, the basking shark. The tiny tuna larvae and the 13-meter-long shark both live off the same food, plankton. Several weeks after the tuna larvae hatch, millions of them will end up as food in the mouth of the giant shark. There is only one way to protect oneself against a certain death in the jaws of a basking shark, and that is to grow quickly. These giants only feed on very small plankton. The tuna that hatched in June will therefore be the size of a grown mackerel by September. That way, by July, the basking sharks will have already lost their appetite for tuna larvae. Back on the Islas Colombretas, Boris now makes his way towards Sicily. The island of Favignana is located off the western coast of Sicily and is part of the Aegean Islands. Favignana has been the embodiment of tuna fishing for a long time. The old tuna factory in the bay is a reminder of the golden past of 1874 and is now a museum. Boris looks for the harbor. The fishermen are preparing for the event of the year, the Matanza. The population on Favignana mostly lives off tourism and tuna. Here, off the coast of Favignana, the tuna that spawn in the eastern Mediterranean get caught in a giant gill net system, similar to that of the Spanish Almadraba. There is no escape from the chamber of death, the Camera del Morte. The fishermen pull up the net and the gruesome killing of the tuna can begin. These are smaller specimens. The pickings get smaller and smaller with each year. The tuna population has been reduced by 92%. Boris is allowed to dive inside the net. He wants to take some video footage for his work. This is a very risky undertaking, in the line of duty for science. It all seems calm. These doomed tuna swim along the net without any panic. Suddenly, the water is seething. A giant white shark went for a tuna. The hungry predators often end up in these tuna traps and then feed until they're delirious. This was close. Our journey continues. We follow the tuna through the Strait of Sicily on their way to the Adriatic and the Eastern Mediterranean. The seaway between Sicily and Tunisia is also a highly frequented shipping route. Great white and mako sharks are very common in this part of the Mediterranean. They follow the ships and the tuna and make this strait a very dangerous place. Several mostly tragic attacks have been recorded here. The most gruesome happened about 100 years ago at the Cape of San Croce. During a giant eruption of Etna, the volcano covered the entire area with large amounts of hot ash and magma. The streaming lava and highly destructive rain of hot ash cut off a family's way from the beach. The parents flee into the ocean with their child and there are attacked by a great white shark. Later, the shark is caught and the fishermen find body parts of each family member. Jawohl. Boris wants to search for great whites with a colleague at this fateful place. During a clear night with a full moon, they install a low-light camera with a motion sensor at the seafloor. These shots of jellies show how sensitive the lens of the camera is. After installing the camera, they surface quickly because these waters are twice as dangerous in the dark. And then, sometime during the night, a shark actually does pass by the camera, but unfortunately not a great white. It is a six-gill shark. These sharks come up into shallow areas from great depth only during the night. At sunrise, Boris is already out and about again, on board of a spadara boat, a swordfish fishing boat. Each bait has a light on it, which is supposed to attract this fast predator. Swordfish react to any kind of light. They are magically drawn to the lights that are attached to the long lines. Due to drastic overfishing, the swordfish population in the Mediterranean has been reduced dramatically. On board the fishing boat, together with Boris, is the renowned fisheries expert Giambattista Bello. He tells Boris that swordfish fishermen have seen tuna mate at night on the surface. The first swordfish is on the hook. The long line is brought in with a machine. The line is 30 kilometers long each time they go out to fish. Swordfish are one of the largest species among the bonefish. Including their sword, they can grow up to 4 meters and weigh up to 500 kilograms. The average weight and length nowadays is much lower. They continue on straight through the night. A blue shark tries to get the swordfish caught on the hook. He would never try this with a free-swimming specimen. The fishermen pull up the swordfish just in time. He has already perished on the hook. Professor Bello and Boris measure the animal. The smaller size is the norm now. The next fish is also small, although this one has a few more pounds on its bones. The scientific statistics clearly show the size of all animals that were caught during the last few years has been getting smaller and smaller. Full-grown swordfish are almost never found anymore. The results of this night are very meager for the fishermen. Change of location. Malta is located southeast of the Strait of Sicily, our next destination. Here are also spawning grounds of the tuna and, in addition, one of the birthplaces of the great white shark. The Rock of Fifla in southern Malta. The waters around this maritime monument are protected. Great whites have been observed in the depths around Fifla. Boris and the shark expert Alex Butikic try everything in their power to observe mating tuna in the open ocean. The steep rock walls go straight down to 30 meters. A grandiose underwater landscape opens up before Boris. Mobula rays, in the same family as the plankton-feeding manta rays, cross through the rock gullies in a formation. Suddenly, tuna swim by, but no sign of mating yet. Boris has a rendezvous, but careful. 230-volt electric current is in effect here. This electric ray is not always fun. They inspect each other with interest and caution on both sides. It's better to keep a bit of distance. There's a false calm on the sand floor. Beneath, a predator is lurking. The the trick of this ray, whirl up a cloud of sand and then disappear. Suddenly, an attack from an angel shark. It appears out of nowhere. The mackerel has no chance. The angel shark is very well camouflaged during its slumber, but Alex has seen it. For this predator, it is of vital importance to stay cool, even if a curious scientist just has to find out if it's a female. Boris had better leave his hands off this tiger moray. Alex Budegig knows this area very well. At this spot, he found a tooth of the ultimate sea monster that lived here 5 million years ago. Carcharoclus megalodon. This shark with giant teeth grew up to 13 meters long. It hunted for whales. The reason for its extinction is completely unknown. It's believed that the evolution of its very specific food source is the reason why it became more and more difficult for the shark to hunt. Descent into the underworld, into the realm of the cave shrimp. Bizarre looking, light sensitive creatures with a tendency to show up in large groups. Countless shrimp inhabit the many caves around Malta. The moray eel seems to like shrimp. One eye is fixed on the divers behind the curtain of shrimp. Sensitive to the light, this stingray leaves its hideout. The predatory conger eel is one of the more curious ones. For Boris, this is the icing on the cake, a black-mouthed cat shark. It lives in greater depth and only rarely comes up to the shallower areas. The journey continues from Malta to Italy. The next destination is Cape San Felice Sirchio, north of Naples. The elongated bay of the small village of Sabaudia is another spawning ground for tuna and great whites, and was the stage for a tragic dive. In September 1962, in the harbor of Sabaudia, the recreational diver Maurizio Sara goes out with two of his friends to spearfish off Cape Felice. The three of them are out at sea every weekend. They know these waters like the back of their hand. But on this day, everything will change. Maurizio checks his harpoon. He does not know that he is being watched from the deep. The trio is out to spear grouper. One of the friends stays with the boat, the other two go down. To be most efficient, they split up. The grouper stays hidden. Therefore, Sara spears the next best fish that he can find, a tragic mistake. Great white senses the blood of the fish, and for Maurizio Sara, there is no escape. Forty-four years later, Boris is on board the research vessel Minibex and on his way to San Felice. With the help of experts and highly developed technical equipment, he wants to search for sharks and tuna in these waters. First of all, they have to fill a container with bait. The bait is then attached to the remote-operated underwater camera robot. Then Achille, so the name of the robot, is launched. It is equipped with high-resolution cameras and is supposed to film pictures from life on the seafloor. Anxious faces in the operation control center. Achille is operated from up here. Will a shark be attracted by it? The lights pick up a large shark. It's not a great white, but a six-gill shark. There are no known attacks on humans from these 5-meter-long sharks, who are mostly active at night, but nevertheless, they are still a bit dangerous. Achille is parked on the seafloor during the night. A small redfish is temporarily blinded by the light. He has his own lights with him, a velvet belly shark. The light creates bacteria that the shark carries with him in special light organs. Boris and the experts are excited. The use of Achille is already a success. But that's not all. Pictures that none of the experts have seen before. A conger eel catches an anglerfish. With his mouth wide open, the anglerfish tries to struggle, but the strong jaws of the eel will not let go. The next morning, it has rained during the night. But the conditions are great for diving. The technicians check the sub Remora. They want to dive on a wreck that is close by. The pilot Ivan Popov and the biologist and cameraman Christian Lott are sitting in the cockpit. The launch of Remora with the crane on the back of the ship is always a difficult maneuver, despite years of experience. Safety diver Jerome Costa loosens the strong hooks on which the 5-ton sub is attached. Highest concentration also on the bridge. Remora has to go down 150 meters. Ivan Popov maneuvers her directly through a school of tuna to the wreck of an Italian hospital ship from the Second World War. During the last few decades, countless organisms have settled on the ship's many structures. An artificial reef has developed. First careful approach towards a biological metropolis. All the different nooks that the wreck offers give many diverse species the opportunity to live together in very close proximity. The current here is rich in plankton, and that supports the growth of this complex community. A school of Mediterranean threadfish lives here, a more rare customer. After 3 hours, the energy supply is running low. Popov has to ascend. The visit in this underwater paradise was worthwhile. From Cape Felice, the journey continues southwards into the open water. Minibex takes course towards one of the most dangerous underwater volcanoes in the world's oceans. Mobile rays make an appearance. With giant leaps out of the ocean, these massive rays try to get rid of their annoying fellow travelers. They're trying to rid themselves of remoras, but unfortunately, only with limited success. Minibex arrives at the destination. Here in the depth of the Tyrrhenian Sea is a ticking time bomb. The Marsilis Seamount, a chain of several massive underwater volcanoes and meanwhile also part of extensive research projects. Achille starts from Minibex to take a first look. Dive depth, more than 500 meters. A common swimming crab gets the shock of a lifetime when it sees the robot. Joystick, keys, and instinct is all Chief Engineer Fred Alcala needs to pilot Achille. Skillfully, he maneuvers the robot through the jagged lava ravines in 540 meters at the peak of the volcano. Surprisingly, there is life in this Mars-like underwater landscape. A sea spider says hello to the camera, and a school of large identics tries to rush by. A filigree tree coral has settled on the rugged lava. Unique tubes come into sight. At closer look, they are a colony of tube worms, a sensation. The fact that they have settled here points toward high volcanic activity. Pure excitement. A small toothed sand tiger shark appears on the monitors. Never before has such a shark been filmed at this depth. These predators can grow up to 4 meters long and prefer to stay around island shelves and continental shelf breaks where they hunt. After our little detour to the Marsilis Seamount, we continue to follow the Tuna towards the Adriatic coast to a strait between the Croatian islands Brač and Hvar. The Hvar Canal. During the summer, this strait between the two islands is a true plankton soup. Ocean currents and sunlight let the microorganisms flourish and attract plankton feeders. On the islands Brač and Hvar, time seems to move slower. In this laid-back environment, things are done slower and with care. No sign of stress here. But during the summer, all that is over with. Basking sharks and tourists arrive at the same time. These giant animals mingle with the bathing tourists and cross between swimmers and boaters. Sharks and people seem to have no fear of each other. Basking sharks and tuna seek out the Hvar Canal for the same reason, plankton. While the sharks seem everywhere and feeding non-stop, the tuna stay hidden. These big-mouthed sharks are closely related to the great white, but are completely harmless for humans. They can grow up to 4 tons and are the largest fish of the oceans directly after the whale shark. Saltwater lampreys are parasites that like to attach to the basking sharks and hook themselves into the shark's skin with their jawless, grater-like mouths. A 10-meter-long basking shark has to feed on 500 kilograms of plankton each day. Per hour, these gentle giants filter about 2,000 liters of water through their gill filtration system. We leave the basking sharks behind and travel from the Adriatic coast to the Turkish Aegean, the furthest eastern point where tuna larvae have been confirmed, the Manchuk Bay. In this idyllic harbor with a picturesque bay, the Turkish shark scientist Hakan Kapasaka from Istanbul is already waiting for his German colleague Boris Frenzel Beimer. The two biologists want to find a very special inhabitant of the shallow coastal waters that Hakan is working on for a scientific project. The boat drive to a secluded sidearm of the Manchuk Bay, where Hakan's subjects live, takes about 1 hour. This area is strictly protected. Because the Manchuk Bay is a protected area, it is closed off to regular boat traffic. This coastal region is a true biological jewel. Every summer, sandbar sharks come into the bay. They're pregnant females. Hakan doesn't know why they are here. Are they trying to get rid of skin parasites in the less salty water, or will they give birth here? Open questions. Boris and Hakan are only allowed to snorkel. Scuba diving is also strictly forbidden in this protected area. In order to protect these rare sharks from tourists, the entire area is now closed off to the general public. Outside, far offshore, the bluefin tuna gather for another long journey. Now it's July and they're finished spawning and will go back to the Atlantic. Following the track of the tuna, we're also going back through the Strait of Gibraltar to the northwestern end of the strait, to the sunny and very stormy Costa de la Luz. A constant stiff wind and wild waves attract kite surfers from around the world to this historic coast. On October 21st, 1805, Admiral Nelson destroyed the Spanish-French fleet here off Cape Trafalgar. The expedition following the track of the tuna comes to an end here at Trafalgar for Boris Frenzel Beimer. Past the Cape Trafalgar, the wide and seemingly endless Atlantic Ocean awaits the fish that have escaped the Almadraba, the Matanza, and the longline fishermen. Their journey through the Mediterranean has finally come to an end. All the fish have to do now is make it to a submarine rock barrier, the threshold of Spartel, the actual border between the Mediterranean and the Atlantic. There, more than enough food awaits the tuna. On the other side of the rocks, cool, nutrient-rich water comes up from the deep, basis for a strong plankton development. Large schools of small crabs, a feast for fish and countless other hungry sea dwellers, which are then eaten by larger predators. Everyone here is hunter and hunted at the same time, a natural hierarchy of species in which life and death balance each other out. The evolutionary engine is running high. An uncompromising contest between abilities and attributes. The faster, stronger, more alert and clever they are, the higher are the chances to come out ahead. The feast of the tuna. After a long journey to spawn, the starving tuna now find enough food at the entrance to the Atlantic. But how much longer? 43 fishing nations want to catch 32,000 tons of tuna in 2007, despite experts' suggestions that only 15,000 tons would be justifiable. Nobody can say at the current time what the consequences of complete eradication of tuna would be for cow nose rays, orcas, dolphins, sharks, and pilot whales. We know for sure that the self-indulgent overexploitation will have consequences, and we will feel them, not only at the sushi bar. No matter what species, once it's extinct, nothing will be the way it was before. Many whale and shark species are equally as endangered as the bluefin tuna. The fact that the tuna and shark populations are collapsing worldwide and that some are close to extinction is the fault of mankind alone. We should think about that next time we order a tuna dish or the increasingly popular shark steaks.